Please hold the line. We will answer your call as soon as possible.
Welcome to this edition of Please Hold. Today, my guest is Ryan Cummins, the co-founder of Omaze. Omaze is an awesome platform where anybody in the world can bid on once-in-a-lifetime experiences. You either get the experience or the money goes to a great cause. And I'm super happy to have you here.
Thanks, Mike. Yeah. Good to be here.
I wanted to start off by talking about your pretty unique education and work background.
Yeah.
You went to Stanford for economics, and that naturally transitioned into content creation.
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
Yeah, that's exactly how those things usually go, right?
Yeah.
Economics into content. So when I was at Stanford, and my co-founder Matt and I, basically we both went to Stanford undergrad. That's where we met. Both shared a deep passion for storytelling, and so I was doing economics as an undergrad. But then every summer I'd come down here to LA and intern for the studio system. So I spent my first couple summers interning first for a woman named Amy Pascal, who was the chairman of Sony, and then
it's a great first internship.
It was amazing. I got to see a lot, take a lot of calls, schlep a lot of coffee, and then for a guy named Sid Gannis, who was the president of the Academy Awards, and Spike Jones, really good director.
So was the economics thing what your parents wanted, and the Hollywood thing what you wanted, or how did that?
Yeah, pretty much. That was the bargain, right? Stanford, it was a great opportunity to learn a lot. I came from Michigan, so I was from Grand Rapids. Stanford was sort of my first entree into seeing how people from all around the world think. And economics is a really great, for a school that didn't have a business undergrad, business major in undergrad, economics was a really nice combination of what I was looking for. But entertainment down here in LA was the storytelling. Okay. And I love storytelling, and so I sort of had those as a balance. And then when I graduated, came down here, started working for the studio system, and then very quickly got involved in some really large cause content campaigns. And that was really what started pathing the way to Omaze today.
As a kid, were you writing stuff? Were you trying to shoot amateur films? Were you always, like, was that always kind of your calling?
Yeah. I think storytelling was always in my calling. I was always really, and going back to middle school and high school, shooting, you know, amateur videos and having a lot of fun with stories, watching movies religiously. And then working on both the studio side and as a PA on some of the films got me deeper into that. The first cause content campaign that I worked on, though, was the first time it was Live Earth. I was the first director on a thing called Live Earth in 2007. Mm-hmm. Largest concert ever thrown. It had, you know, in 8 months they put together 150 music superstars around the world in 7 different cities. So it was everyone from Kanye to the Red Hot Chili Peppers to Madonna, you name it. And that was the first time that I saw storytelling combined with, at that time, Al Gore was spearheading that, so it was around climate change. And so storytelling of musicians and something that was very impactful and very meaningful at that specific moment in time. And so that's when sort of my passion for storytelling started veering into cause content campaigns.
So it wasn't just, let's create some cool content for the world, it's let's create cool content that benefits a cause that I believe in.
Yeah, and that you could see like tangible results on right away. It just felt more fulfilling.
Yeah. So you worked in content creation for 7 years, and then you went back to school for your MBA.
Yeah.
Why?
Naturally. It's a very clear path, right? So I worked on Live Earth, and then I went and I did a media property called Untitled Thinkers, which I created. So I filmed a couple hundred interviews with Nobel Prize winners, MacArthur Genius Grant recipients, Pulitzers, interesting thinkers around the world, and kept going deeper and deeper down this social impact theme. And was talking with my co-founder Matt, and he was working on a thing at the time called 10 by 10, which turned into Girl Rising, a documentary about educating girls in the developing world. So we were both on these parallel paths around cause content. But we were creatives, and we were very passionate about the space, but didn't have a model that could grow or scale or have a sustainable revenue stream to it. And when we took a survey of the entire landscape of cause content, that was something that we saw was really endemic to the space. A lot of people out there putting on these very large campaigns that would raise a lot of awareness, but not really create a commensurate amount of impact. And so we decided to go back to B school, and you know, we joke, when you go into B school, there are a lot of people coming in from investment or consulting, and they're coming in at like a 50 and leaving at a 70. we were going in at like a 1, 2, or 3 in terms of our education of business and leaving at a 30, but that was like a much larger leap for us.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So you just felt you needed more of a business background to make a business out of what you loved.
That's right.
Content creation.
Yeah. So okay. it was really by necessity.
And you guys, you both went to, actually you went to UCLA and he went to Wharton. Is that right?
Came here to Anderson.
Okay. But you guys timed it, so you did it sort of together, or you did it around the same
everything
time?
Everything is like double dutch, right? Just naturally. It just so happens. We didn't really necessarily try and time it at the same time. It just worked out that way.
Okay.
And while we were there, we were trading ideas back and forth, and then both ended up at this gala that the Boys and Girls Club was hosting, where they were honoring Magic Johnson as sort of their recipient of the year, and it was the National Boys and Girls Club gala. And so he stands up, and I'm sure you've been to these, you know, what we jokingly call rubber chicken dinners. Magic stands up, and we're lifelong Magic fans. And so he starts auctioning off the chance to hang out with him, sit courtside at a Lakers game, and it's this dream experience. And our hands are like the first to shoot up at an auction. But this is a small room, you know, 200 wealthy individuals. So at $10, our hands are up. $50, hands are up. 100, they're
that
up.
That experience started at $10. That's amazing.
Yeah, probably didn't, but that's, our hands went up before they started the auction.
Okay. So in my whatever mind, the price was.
It was $10, yeah. And then it went to 500, and I'm sitting there thinking, like, that's a quarter of a month's rent here in Los Angeles when you're in B school and sharing, like, a small two-bedroom. And then it went to 5,000, and we're out, and 10,000, and then it ultimately cleared for $15,000. And to throw salt on the wound, I knew the guy who had purchased it, and he wasn't a Magic Johnson fan or a Lakers fan. And so it was like,
why'd he buy it?
Because you're in a room at this gala, you care for the charity, so he was gonna donate to something anyway. And that's often what happens at these galas. And so we were driving home, and we said, you know, think about how much more money. Magic's this global icon, right? He has fans around the world. How much more money and how much awareness the Boys and Girls Club could have garnered if for $10 anybody online had a chance to win. And that's really where the idea was born.
So obviously the auction system, like you were in, works, and if there's wealthy people in the room, it's just going to keep getting bid up, but only one person's going to win.
Yeah.
You, when you started Omaze, you really went to a random raffle system, right?
So
anybody has an equal chance to win, and they're all paying the same amount.
Yeah, so it works like a raffle. Technically, you can't do raffles online, but it works similar to a raffle. And
so how do you get around that technicality?
It's a sweepstakes.
Okay.
So there is a free alternative method of entry. But because of the, you know, the behavior economics of these, when they're involved in philanthropy, a very small percentage of people actually do that. And they're also users that are captive users. So we started this, sort of a new innovative take on it. And when we did it, you know, we and I think our investors, no one was sure whether or not it was going to work. Would the charities believe in it? Would the celebrities buy on? And we did our first campaign was Cupcake Wars. We had a friend, Justin Willeman, who's a really fantastic host here in LA, and he was hosting this TV show, and that one made $700. And
what exactly are Cupcake Wars?
It's a TV show where you make cupcakes,
okay,
and then people judge how good those cupcakes are.
Oh, okay. I was thinking of something way more violent where you're like throwing cupcakes
at each other. Yeah, maybe that would have been, you know, had more seasons. But Cupcake Wars, it was great. Justin's an amazing person. They were a wonderful group to be able to let us do that. But it made $700. And so we were looking at that and thinking, all right, if this is going to scale, we obviously have to make a lot more per experience.
So does that mean 70 people bid $10?
$10.
To be on the show?
Well, you can donate more. So if you can donate for a chance to win, for every $10 you donate, you get 100 chances to win an experience. So if you donate $100, when you donate more, you actually get physical goods. So if you donate $100, we'll do limited edition t-shirts. At $250, you might get a framed painting. You get autographed goods at even higher levels. And what happened is, as we got better at taking our DNA of storytelling and really using that as the marketing engine to drive promotion for these experiences, they grew. And so we went from Cupcake Wars, which made $700, to an experience with Parks and Recs, the TV show, which did $20,000. And then we did one with Jon Stewart that did $60,000, one with Linkin Park that did $100,000. I had one with ESPN that did 200,000 in 24 hours. And wow. For that moment, we thought our site was broken, and then we found out it wasn't. And then we did one with Breaking Bad. So I'm going back to 2013 right now. But our one with Breaking Bad did $1.7 million to go to the season finale of Breaking Bad. You got to get dressed up in a hazmat suit and ride in a Winnebago with Aaron Paul. And that's when we knew, all right, we really have something.
What's your business model? Do you take a cut?
So of the gross donations that are raised, we align ourselves with the charity, take third-party costs off the top. So that's the cost of flying a winner out, credit card processing fees. And then we push 80% of the gross proceeds on to the charity.
Okay. So $1.7 million is an over $300,000 revenue to the company.
To
you.
If it's strictly 20%, yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Cool. And what was what made that key difference? I mean, there's a huge difference between $700 and $1.7 million, and obviously you're getting bigger names as you grow. But what did you discover in the psychology of people that made it work?
Well, we got a lot better at, we focused a lot on the e-commerce of it all. So we focused a lot on the site, focused a lot on the user experience, making sure that the flow was really simple, very straightforward, that anybody could come on. You know, we thought it would be successful if our moms came onto the site and knew exactly how to use it, and we got there.
Love the mom test.
The mom test is always the best test, right?
The grandma test is even a higher bar.
I can imagine that. So my grandma was pretty savvy with computers back in the day, but that's a good bar. Yeah. So we got past the mom test, and then the storytelling. I mean, so our DNA is in storytelling and technology. You know, the higher purpose of this company is we serve world changers. The mission statement for the company is to build a community that leverages the power of story and technology to transform lives. And so we really had to get good at the technology first, the e-commerce, the flow, make sure that everything made sense. And then we layered on the storytelling. And when we did that, these experiences really started to grow. And everyone, it's a net win for everybody. You know, the celebrity gets more awareness for causes that they care about.
Is it always for a cause? Do they ever just keep the money?
No, always for a cause. Okay. Yeah, so and that's one of the things that separates us from other folks out there is we're always doing this. Our company is built on impact. It's built on philanthropy.
Yep.
And so the charities are our beneficiaries doing incredible work out in the world. These celebrities care a lot about those charities. And the donors, even if they come on initially for an experience, they end up learning about the beneficiaries. They end up learning about these incredible charities that are really doing some life-changing work out there and staying on and going from experience to experience.
What is the most successful experience to date?
Star Wars. So we've done a couple Star Wars campaigns. We've raised over $6.3 million, and we're excited that in the near future we may be able to do some more.
Wow. $6.3 on a single...
$3 million
on a single
on two campaigns.
Yeah.
Okay. So the first one was the launched by a partnership between Disney, Lucasfilms, and Bad Robot. J.J. Abrams and Katie McGrath are a husband, wife, and partnership co-CEO structure over at Bad Robot, and brilliant humanitarians, very very thoughtful, very caring. And when J.J. took the helm directing Star Wars: The Force Awakens, they talked with Disney and Lucasfilm, and collectively the groups wanted to do something very philanthropic with the property. They knew that they had a global fan base that they could unite. And so we actually kicked off on the very first day of production. JJ released a video from set that showed one of the first aliens on Star Wars, but that also announced that you could have the chance to be in the movie.
Wow.
And then later on, to close the campaign, he unveiled the X-Wing for the very first time.
So you guys work with the celebrities to figure out how to tell the story?
Yeah, so we have probably one of the most, I'd say one of the most creative teams in the world here at Omaze. A lot of very young, extremely energetic, passionate, philanthropic people here.
And so you tell them who it's with and what the experience is gonna be, and they just start spitballing and coming up with ideas.
And so we come up with the experience design with the, we partner with a celebrity and charity, so we'll come up with the experience design, with the content. We have our own in-house production team. We have a marketing team that's top-notch that will come up with a full strategy from social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, paid. We do, we partner with online outlets to basically get it spread even further with TV distribution. So if it's Good Morning America or the Today Show, to get our best videos launched there. We have a PR team that helps spread the word even further. And then we have this community of nearly 2 million people that go from campaign to campaign now, all organically grown.
Wow.
Yeah, so 70% of our donations on any given campaign come from earned media.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Do you ever have celebrities that don't have a charity and they just want to do something good and you connect them with a charity? Or does everybody kind of already have the cause they want to support?
The vast, vast majority of the time, any celebrity that you meet is going to have a cause that they already care about,
okay.
At least in our case. These are some of the brightest, most influential people on the planet. And incredibly creative, bright people care a lot about the world, and they care a lot about changing the world. And so when we partner with them, we try not to do the matchmaking, because the best campaigns happen when there's already a match there, and we can just provide them with a platform to really demonstrate that to the world and bring on donors and bring on additional partners that get that word spread.
Did Magic Johnson invest?
Magic didn't invest. No, we actually didn't invite him to invest, but we should have.
You totally should have. He's the inspiration for the company, it sounds like.
It's the magic.
Did you ever get to hang out with him or play basketball with
him? Yeah, we actually did an experience with him and Red in the first year that we did. We've launched our third year now of doing an experience with Red around World AIDS Day, mm-hmm. and we got to do an experience with Magic. It was
what'd you do?
With Magic, you got to. God, what did you do with Magic? I'm blanking on that for a second. You got to go to a Lakers game.
Okay.
But I didn't go to the Lakers game, which is why I don't remember the experience. Yeah.
So you still have never done that experience with Magic.
I still have not gone to a Lakers game with
that,
Magic.
That thorn in your side that you had to start the company. You
got
to
keep something that you always dream about. You know.
Do you ever participate? Or do you yourself ever bid and say, this is so good, I just want it?
Yeah, so we technically can't win.
Okay.
No one in, none of our employees or family members by law are allowed to bid or win. You can bid to get
maybe a wife's friend or a girlfriend's friend? Or
like Michael Schneider percent, you know,
I mean,
who knows?
I'm happy to
go on.
To
help. What would be your dream experience?
Oh, man. I'm not a huge sports guy, so it probably wouldn't be. I mean, I think Magic Johnson's amazing, but I think I respect him equally for what he's done with inner cities and his cinemas and all that stuff. I mean, I think Bill Gates or somebody like that that has had such a huge impact on the world, I would love to be a fly on the wall for a day of meetings, literally just listening to how he thinks and how he analyzes things. And there's other people I could think of, but.
Like,
I don't know if I'd be interacting with the person as much as I'd just be observing and learning how somebody that I respect and has accomplished great things handles their day.
Like Shadow Gates for a day.
Shadow Gates for a day would be cool.
That'd be pretty cool. Yeah. What type of day?
I got $10 on that.
You got $10 on that?
Yeah.
All right. I'll take it right now as a down payment on a future experience.
My wallet is right over there.
Yeah, you can Venmo me.
Gates, I think Branson would probably be interesting, although I feel like he's a much more hands-off guy, and Gates really gets in the weeds.
We're doing a Branson one right now.
Oh, what are you doing?
Yeah, you get to race cars with Richard Branson.
Well, that's pretty cool.
Another one. And we've been talking about doing another one around a safari with him.
Okay, so I'll give you $10 for Gates and $10 for Branson.
If we keep this conversation going, this could be a really impactful meeting.
It is. And we're going to launch this, and depending on the timing, a lot of other people will potentially give.
What would be the charity that you would want to support?
Oh, man. I think that Planned Parenthood, funny enough, is so under attack right now with the incoming administration. This is going to date this interview. But
yeah, not at all.
Inauguration that's happening in 2 days that I feel like I would want to support it just because it's so under attack.
Yeah.
I also just had a daughter a year ago and feel like she should kind of have the right to do what she wants with her body.
Yeah.
So that's one. I'm a big champion of anything that tries to help homeless people not be homeless. And so there's a great initiative going on in LA right now. Where they're building housing for homeless, and it's going to include job training and disease control and all sorts of amazing stuff.
Yeah.
So anything along those two lines are the first things that come to my head.
Yeah, and LA needs that.
LA does need it.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have the second biggest homeless population in the country.
Yeah. So we're right now looking into that and doing a lot to try and take the combined resources and effort that we have here and put it towards that.
Okay. Great. So we got Gates shouting for a day. supporting LA homelessness.
This has been super productive.
I'm in.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is a creative meeting. You didn't
realize
that.
That's right, yeah.
So you guys are obviously a for-profit company.
Yeah.
But you are supporting the nonprofit world.
Yeah.
Was it even an option to, usually when you think of people that support nonprofits, it's nonprofit work, but you guys aren't like that. Was that ever an option to be a nonprofit company?
When we first started Omaze, you know, it was in response to the fact that we'd been filmmakers who were continually chasing funds to try and fund our passion. And so we took a very different approach, which is we look at for-profits as a solution to the nonprofit sector. Philanthropy, now more than ever, and especially as government continues to defund a lot of the most remarkable charities that are out there, needs other solutions. And those solutions are going to have to come from the for-profit sector. And so when we launched this, we really thought, okay, we could start a foundation that ultimately is continually seeking its own grants to be able to fund remarkable causes out there. Or we could really focus on building a for-profit company that could grow and scale and continually have the capital that allows us to really go out there and select the charities that we're helping and doing that on a repeat basis to have the most impact globally. And so we've gotten to a point now where through this model, we've had donors from over 170 countries all participating. We've helped well over 250 charities at this point in time. You know, we've launched over 300, and I think last time it was over 300 campaigns. We're probably at 350 now.
What's the total raised?
We've raised over $60 million.
Okay.
Yeah, wow. For charity.
Fantastic.
Yeah, it's been great.
You know, another, this is a nonprofit, but Charity Water is an organization I really respect. And
yeah,
it's interesting to think about, could a nonprofit be more impactful in their cause as a for-profit? I don't know the answer.
Yeah. I think every one of the, if you're a for-profit, if you're a nonprofit, government, every one of those sectors serves a purpose. And there are certain things that you can do in each sector that you can't in the other.
Yeah.
I think finding ways to convene all three is really where you find that secret sauce.
You probably would have had trouble raising money from investors as a nonprofit.
Yeah, it's a different type of investor that really wants to invest in a nonprofit.
Yeah.
Gates is a really good one, a good example of that.
Gates is a good example of that. Mm-hmm. You're right. So
theme here.
You mentioned Untitled Thinkers, which was super interesting. I don't think we're at this level with this podcast yet. But I'm curious how you started that, how you got in touch with them, how you got such amazing people to sit in front of the camera.
Yeah.
Give me some tips.
So this was the number one thing that I learned. There were a couple things I learned. One of them is I listened to my first 10 interviews after I did them, and I wanted to slit my throat, because in listening to the first 10 interviews, I realized I would do this thing where, you know, I'd be sitting in front of someone like Noam Chomsky and ask him a question, and then right as he's about to give like that pure nugget of gold, I'd give him like my take on what he was talking about. And I literally went back and was listening to all these interviews and just scratching my neck and pulling my hair out, because I was ruining the interviews by trying to give my idea of what mattered. And really what I learned, and there's a guy, a really famous interviewer who did decades and decades of interviews, his name's Studs Terkel, and he would just always come up with, and then what happened? And then what happened as the line, and then what? And I learned that learning how to sit with the discomfort of silence and allowing someone to give their first answer, and then their third and their second, or their second and their third.
That comes with confidence, right? Because probably the first time or second time you do it, if there's dead air, you're like,
you're nervous,
I'm not doing my job,
right? It's not going well.
Yeah.
And really, it's on the other side of that nervous vacuum where you really dive into some gold.
Yeah.
So I learned to shut up, which was an extremely valuable lesson. And in the process of learning that, I realized how little I actually knew about the world. You know, there's that poem, like a wise old owl sat in a tree. The less he spoke, the more he'd see. The more he'd see, the more he heard. Why aren't we like that old bird? And that's a really silly poem to explain, that basically sitting there silently gives you a lot of interesting perspective when you give someone else the opportunity to share it.
So that's great once you're already in front of them. How'd you get in front of these amazing people?
So I started a deal with everybody where if they liked my interview process and they generally liked the questions I was asking them, they had to recommend the next three people to be on the list. And what I found as a result of doing that is that everybody wants to be on a list with bigger names than theirs. And so I ended up creating this network effect where everybody introduced really interesting people.
That is a astoundingly simple and brilliant idea
that
I'm going to start with today.
Do it.
And I'm going to hit you up just
for the next three people. All
Absolutely.
Right. There's a guy named Michael Schneider you should interview.
That'd be a little schizophrenic. I'm curious, so you mentioned Project Earth.
I don't know if you know this, but my last company, Mobile Brody, actually did one of the original iOS apps for Project Earth.
Awesome.
And so I got to know those guys well. Actually, the office was on Wilshire, just across the street from my office.
Oh, is that right?
And so I'd walk over.
I worked across the street from you.
All right, so maybe we saw each other in that past life. I'm curious how you would compare Project Earth and that work to the Clinton Foundation. I know they're completely different animals, but in terms of impact and culture and everything else.
So the biggest difference would be that with Live Earth, they were strictly focused on climate change. They were approaching it from entertainment first as a way of building awareness around the work of Al Gore and what he had been doing with Inconvenient Truth, and trying to raise awareness, and then ultimately through that convening corporate partners to raise funding for that project. With the Clinton Foundation, and these are just as structures, so I'll describe that first. With the Clinton Foundation, you know, which has been dissolved, but
the foundation's been dissolved, or the initiative?
CGI's been dissolved. But with the Clinton Foundation, what they've been focused on is they had these eight pillars, which hit these different things around the world. My relationship to both of them was that in each case, I was really being brought on as a director and a producer to create entertaining content that would help draw awareness. So for the Live Earth project, I literally trapped myself in a room for 2 months and went through a couple hundred hours of climate change footage, and then a couple hundred hours of music footage, and
I walked away depressed.
Yeah, exactly. I learned a lot. I learned a tremendous amount about how to take really dry information and figure out how to message it in an entertaining way that is digestible in small snippets. And
probably could have made an Inconvenient Truth even more interesting.
I don't want to poo-poo Inconvenient Truth. They did
No, it was an amazing movie.
But yeah, I mean, well, especially nowadays, post-social media, I mean, Inconvenient Truth would have to be in little short, you know, two-minute blocks to get back out there again.
Is that about the right amount of time? Do you think 2 minutes is people's attention span online?
I think 2 minutes is sort of the sweet spot. And now, with social media, it's 2 minutes plus type with font on the actual screen. Mm-hmm. You need chyrons, and you need subtitles to everything, and the companies that are doing it best are actually putting like very colorful subtitles across all of their videos, because most people watch on silent.
Yep.
And so I learned that, and then with the Clinton Foundation, there was again a concert, so it was the same group that produced it, and this was a globally televised event at the Hollywood Bowl where they had Stevie Wonder and Bono, and we got to film interviews with Tony Blair and Bill Gates and Jay-Z and all these really incredible people, and turn that into five different pieces that would explain the work of the foundation in an entertaining way. If you have time, you should watch. There's a video we did called Celebrity Division, and that was, again, Matt and I partnered on that and ended up spending 2 days in New York filming Ben Stiller and Jack Black and Sean Penn and Matt Damon and Ted Danson and Mary Steenburgen and Kristen Wiig and Kevin Spacey and Bill Clinton, all basically...
all at the same time, or these are all separate?
So in the video, they're all around the same conference room.
Oh,
but
wow.
A little secret is that we filmed them all at different times.
Interesting.
Yeah, with the exception of Ben, Ted, and Mary, everyone else filmed at a different time.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Do you ever have any ethical conflicts with charities that you guys are asked to support? Like,
yeah.
Do your personal beliefs get in the way?
Sure. So I think that, one has to separate themselves and their personal ideas from the company if you're really going to have an open platform. But we definitely do have this belief that we're built on these core principles of empowering others. And so so long as the message and the work of the charities and the people, specifically the people acting as the spokespeople, be it the celebrity or the charity themselves, are using language and messaging that's empowering others, we're open to working with them. you know, there have been a select few cases where people approached us where they wanted to build campaigns that weren't necessarily built on empowering others, but on displacing others. And in those cases, we had to graciously pass. But for the vast majority of the cases, people, I think, are partners. We've been fortunate to work with people that really want to improve the world.
What is the favorite experience, if you have one, that you guys have created?
You
have to choose one.
So I love this. There's an arc that I really like. And that was, there was a charity that we partnered with in 2015 called Julia's House. It was a hospice center for kids. And so a really hard thing. And so they came to us because they wanted to raise $1.75 million to build a second hospice center. And they wanted to partner up with Robert Downey Jr. And when they came to us, what I hadn't realized is that, and now, you know, I'm married, but we don't have, Lisa and I don't have any kids yet. You have a new daughter, so I'm sure it hits you in a whole different way to think about a hospice center for kids and what that means to parents. And what I didn't know at the time was that hospice centers don't just serve these kids who've been dealt this, you know, incredibly awful hand. They service the parents who sometimes go years with only getting 2-3 hours of sleep a night. The siblings of these kids who can be, you know, 3, 4, 5 years old, going through their life for the very first time and having no idea why their family and all of the energy of the family is being poured at this child and not understanding what that's about and sometimes why they're missing out on a normal life and love. And so these hospice centers provide a place where the kids who've been dealt this awful hand can go and meet other kids and actually enjoy themselves, where the parents can get 6, 7, 8 hours of sleep continuously and know that their child is being cared for, and where the siblings of these kids can actually meet other siblings and suddenly understand that they're not alone in the world. And so they provide this incredible service of decency to people and a dignified life. And so
a wonderful cause.
A wonderful cause, Julia's House. And so they wanted to build a second hospice center. And they said that usually that would take them about 2 years. And when Robert Downey Jr. got word of this, he said, okay, I'm going to get behind this and I'm going to put on the best experience ever. It's going to be to live the best day of your life with Robert Downey Jr. He has a very big, passionate fan base, and he's going to take them, you know, the winner and her friends are going to fly out to L.A. They're going to take a helicopter over Hollywood Boulevard. They're going to go indoor skydiving. They're then going to get suited up for a tux, sit down, have a caviar toast with Robert Downey Jr., ride in a motorcade with him to the premiere of Avengers, and then hang out with him at the after party. And in 5 weeks, that raised over $2 million.
Wow.
And Julia's House has since built the second hospice center. As a result of that campaign, they've become one of the most innovative hospice centers in the entire UK, been awarded that, and they've become an advisor to other hospice centers around the world. RDJ, Robert Downey Jr., was so inspired by this campaign that he actually launched a brand new charity through Omaze last year called Random Act Funding. And in this past year, through the $2 million he raised on his second campaign, in half the time, by the way, he ended up supporting 8 new causes. And we're just gearing up right now to do our third campaign with him.
That's incredible.
Yeah. So
I hope you sleep well at night. You're doing a lot of good in the world.
There's a lot of good that needs to be done, you know. and look, at all credit goes to the celebrities, to the charities, and to this team. I just happen to be sitting here.
Very modest. Final question is around AI. AI is a huge buzzword in tech right now, obviously. We're using AI to try to solve customer service. I'm curious how you think AI applies to your industry. Am I one day going to be bidding on an artificial intelligence basketball experience with Magic Johnson? Or, you know, does it impact?
Right. So the first thing that comes to my mind with AI is the way in which charities are being impacted by it. So you look at the different things that some specific charities are actually doing on the ground, but that also large companies like Google and Facebook are doing to basically come up with data aggregation to understand the trends that are taking place around the world, and then the tools through AI that can be used to actually address those issues in the most effective manner. You know, Omaze right now is not necessarily using AI on our experiences. So I can't say that, like.
And I sort of conflated. So yeah. AI is one thing, VR is obviously another.
Okay.
Do you think that you, one day I'll bet an experience where I'll put on my Oculus and have that experience.
Ah, I see what you're saying. So we are focused on creating impact by offering people to have experiences that they'd otherwise never be able to have. At the point in time that AI serves up experiences that are so unique and not ubiquitous for everybody, but could really be fashioned in such a way that one individual person could get it and really have something that everybody wants to take a shot at and donate money for, then yeah, absolutely we'd do
it. I suppose by definition, the answer is no, because the real unique experience is always going to be the in-person experience.
It's always in person.
The celebrity only has one of them.
But I mean, if you get to go have an AI experience with Robert Downey Jr., then I'm sure that that would be a combination of those two things.
Yeah.
So why do you ask the question on AI?
It's just such a hot trend right now.
Okay.
And I'm always curious how different industries are adapting and thinking about it, and in your case, if it even applies.
Yeah. We have so much that we need to accomplish before we even get to that stage that I think we're really focused on creating a brand new industry right now. AI obviously is sweeping, so at some point in time that's going to become more at the forefront of what we're doing. But right now there's some still basic building blocks that we're tackling.
Yeah, cool, man. Well, listen, you guys are doing a lot of good in the world.
Yeah.
And it's great to have you on.
Thanks, Michael. Appreciate it.
Did you like what you just saw? You want to see more? Go ahead and subscribe. We have new episodes every Tuesday. And if there's someone you want to see on the show, just add them as a comment down below. We'll take a look and we'll have them on if we can. Thanks again.